joined us today, that you feel the love of Jesus, because love gathers here at DCOG. We have additional ministries available to each of you on Sunday mornings so that you can grow even deeper in your walk with Jesus. We offer BLTs, Body Life Teams, for adults and kids before service at 9 a.m. There's nursery care for our babies available during our BLT hour and church. The nursery is located at the west end of the building. There is Kids Church for ages 5 years through grade 4 that we dismiss throughout the service. They sing, hear the message about Jesus, and have a really fun time together. Now, during the week, there are life groups for adults for you to join that meet either here at the church or in people's homes. A Bible study for both men and women meet here on Wednesday nights at 6:30 p.m., as well as our Purpose Youth Group. So if you have any kids that are between the ages of 5th and 12th grade, we welcome them to join the fun. Now, one of our ushers gave you a program as you came in that has info and activities going on here at DCOG. However, here are some things we would like for you to be aware of. Coming up this Thursday, May 6th, in front of the courthouse in downtown Decatur, the Decatur Ministerial Association will be observing the National Day of Prayer. It will begin at noon. We hope to see you there. It is camp season, kids. Our YCL camp is ready to once again have youth camps. It is tons of fun, and you will not stop talking about it once you attend. Our camp is located just outside Silver Lake, about an hour and 15 minutes northwest of here. The camps take place all throughout June at different times for different age groups. This is a great way to invite your friends and hang out at a really special place. There is zip lining, archery, the Gaga Pit, crafts, awesome swimming, many more activities, and you do this all while learning and growing closer to Jesus. Parents, if you're looking to have your children be involved in something,
Ed Hershey said the beauty of technology. So I'm going to tell you this morning, welcome to DCOG. To give you a couple of the announcements that were on that video that maybe some of you wouldn't have heard anyways. But we do have this coming Thursday in front of the courthouse, between the courthouse and the post office, we have the DMA National Day of Prayer. It starts at noon. So if you want to join us for that, that'll be at noon. It'll go for about half an hour or so, half an hour, 45 minutes. So we have that. We also have our Senior Connection ministry that will be meeting that same day on Thursday at 10:30. There's a special speaker here. You don't want to miss her testimony. I believe it's Lori Landis' sister. So she'll be sharing on Thursday. And we also want to make a plug for our YCL ministry camps. We are still taking registrations for that, and you don't want to miss out. If you have a son or daughter, or you have a grandkid that you want to help get them closer to Jesus, you don't want to miss out on this opportunity. If your child or grandchild attends our ministry regularly, either the youth or the children's ministry, the church will pay 50% of that fee. That is a steal for 1 week. And trust me when I tell you, when they go, it will be so memorable. And if they go and they're grade 6 through 8, it'll really be memorable because Pastor Jamie will be one of the counselors at that camp. So we'll see how memorable that will be. So there we go. I think that's all the announcements that are there. So we're going to worship real quick. You know what? Joy comes in the morning. Joy comes in the morning, church. And I got to tell you, I love that phrase because when you go through an entire day and you put your head down and you're tired, you just hit a wall. I guess we had a great church outing yesterday for our golf at Cross Creek, and I hit a wall. Dave Krickberg said he hit a wall on Facebook. He hit a wall. But you put your head down, you wake up the next day, it's a new day. It's a clean slate with the Lord. It's a clean slate. Joy does come in the morning, and God's woken us up. We are alive and we are breathing. Let's worship together. Well, hold your heart, what stirs your soul? When matters come to mind, the cares you keep, the thoughts you think, it's not a wasted time. Seek and you will find. Stand together, come on. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, praise the Lord. Don't stop dancing and dreaming. There's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. The years roll by. We wonder why. We lost our way from home. Our Father finds child inside. We left for growing old. Sing a church, awake. Awake, awake, awake my soul. Sing a church. Joy still comes in the morning. Hope still walks with the hurting. If you're still alive and breathing, dancing and dreaming, there's still good news worth repeating. So lift your head and keep singing. Praise the Lord. Let everything, praise the Lord. Sing it. Let everything, praise. Sing that, church. The Lord praise this morning, church.
Let us pray together. Father, we have come here today to praise you. All we have to do is count our blessings. They are more than we can count. And we can only say thank you, and we praise you, for you are a wonderful God. In spite of the circumstances we face, you're always there, and we love you, and we thank you. And today, as we worship together, may we give you honor and praise. In your holy and righteous name, we pray. Amen.
Put your hands together. You know this, sing it with me.
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God forevermore. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way.
Here we go.
Cause He hung up on that cross, then He rose up from that grave. My God still always knows a way. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord. We all be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in His place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise.
All kinds of people are welcome into the house of the Lord. No matter what your baggage is.
We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing His praise.
Sing it, come on.
We were the beggars, now we're royalty, yeah. We were the prisoners, now we're running. Forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing His praise.
Sing it, come on.
There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today.
We won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout.
Hands together for worshiping the Lord this morning. Here's one.
Blessed assurance,
Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, heirs of God, born of His Spirit, in His blood. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior. This is my song, is He my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of pride. Now burst on my side. Angels descending, rain from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior.
Have a story this morning? If you do, I want you to shout it.
This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my
church.
My song, praising my
And all God's people said, amen. You may be seated.
It sure is good to be back. We were just gone one Sunday, but it feels like much more than that because we missed you all. And it's so great to see your lovely faces and to experience your greetings and your kind words. And you're just special people. Have I told you that recently? You're special people. You really are. And we're so glad to be back. I was thinking a moment ago, Jamie, when we had that little sound glitch there, when we went to Branson a couple weeks ago, and I mean, it just seemed like everything was trying to work against us. I mean, Jamie had put together this tremendous trip, and everything was just falling together in order. But once we got there, those of you who went, you know what it's like. You remember? I mean, it was one thing after another. The bus broke down, and yet we made it through, and we went to Jesus' story, and we were sitting there, and all of a sudden the power went out. For an hour, it was out, and they had, I don't even know if their generators were going at the beginning, but they were able to get some partial power back, and then after an hour, it started up again, and we got to see the most fabulous presentation of our Lord and his life. And it snowed. We didn't get as much as you all, but boy, it was we were all saying, what next? You know, what's next? But you know, I got to tell you, this is why I'm so proud of you folks. With all that we went through, everybody on that bus was just full of kindness and encouragement and cheer. And whatever happens, God is here, and that's who we are, folks. And I was so proud of our group, and I've never enjoyed a trip more than that trip. Next year when we do that, some of you wannabes in this, you know, senior connection. That's right. Yeah, you can go too, James.
There's a next year, Pastor.
We'll do it again. Okay. You know, we'll take two or three buses if we have to. But folks. It was great, and Chris and I enjoyed worshiping with my twin brother and his wife at their church of the Nazarene last Sunday in Wichita, Kansas, and it was a wonderful service, but we couldn't help but think of you all, and to be here with the worship team, you all are incredible. You're just incredible. I appreciate you all, and God has blessed us, folks, and we need to thank him for it. And we're going to take communion here, as we do usually the first Sunday of the month. And appreciate those who have gotten it together for us so that we can all together share in Holy Communion. And if you did not get an element cup when you came in, just raise your hand. The ushers can wait upon you. They'll bring you a cup so you can take communion together with us. And those of you online, we welcome you to this service. And if you want to hurry up and get some elements together, feel free to do that. We'll wait on you, but we're glad you're part of us. There's a wonderful passage of Scripture, which I think reminds us what communion is all about. Jesus was gathered with his disciples, according to Luke, on that Last Supper evening. And when they came together, Jesus said to them, find the right verse here. Verse 14 of chapter 22, it says, when the hour came, Jesus and his apostles reclined at the table. And he said to them, I have eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. I have earnestly desired to share this meal with you before I suffer, Jesus was saying. Jesus was saying, I really, 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 really want to share this meal with you. That's how much you mean to the Lord. And as we come together to remember what our Lord has done for us, I want to ask you for a few moments here to just tune in to the Spirit of the Lord who is saying, I really want this time with you, and tell him how much it means to you. Will you spend a few moments before we share the elements together? And Jesus took the bread, he gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Take and drink. We understand now why you told the Apostle Paul as he wrote to the church at Corinth, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. And our Lord, we do remember you, and we thank you for your great sacrifice on the cross that provided for us that grace and mercy gift of redemption. And that when we just come to you, we confess our sins. You are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we have a relationship with you, not built on works, but given to us by your grace. God's riches at Christ's expense. And you have poured out your love upon us, Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ. You have shown us the way to live. You have taught us how to live. And you provided that through this great sacrifice, and we remember you and what you have done for us. Receive our thanks. For really, really, really loving us. And Father, it's such a joy for us to be together in this church, in this family of believers and seekers. Lord, as we reach out to know you better, as we seek what you want for us, we do that together as a church, as a family, together in Christ. And we thank you that you have brought us together here at Decatur Church of God, and you have given us a purpose, and together we support and love and encourage one another. Every person here and those listening online is important to you. But everybody in the world is important to you. For God so loved the world that he gave. Lord, may we give our lives back to you, to be used by you for your honor and glory, to reach out to the world that you love and bring people into the family of God through Jesus Christ our Lord. And as a family, as we pray here today, we want to especially lift up these needs on the back of our worship folder. We just know there are many great needs among us here today. We lift up the Call family, and especially Ashley, and in her battle with cancer, and her family, her wonderful family. And we just pray they will sense your ever-present spirit with them, ministering to them, leading them, guiding them, providing for them. And bring comfort where there are struggles, and bring peace where there is lack of peace. Bring that joy in the morning because they know you and they know that you are with them. Lord, we pray your sustaining grace upon Ashley, that you'll strengthen her day by day. Father, we remember Kathy Steinecker's special need, and there are many others like her going through these kinds of struggles, needing your healing touch upon their bodies, and we just lift them up for you. There are so many needs in our church family. May we be faithful this week in supporting each one through prayer. We pray for our country in such turmoil, that in our land there is so much hatred and so much division. Lord, may we as your people be the ones to bring peace and comfort and love and reconciliation to this divided land. Father, as we continue to worship today, we ask that you'll speak to our hearts. And Father, we want to thank you for the way you provide for us financially, and for those who are faithfully in their giving, supporting the outreach and ministry of this church. We know that all good and gracious gifts come from above. They come from you. And we give you thanks as we give back to you and your ministry and your mission here on earth. And we pray these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The children are dismissed for children's church at this time.
How great the chasm there between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. And through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy?
Sing it, church.
What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation.
Sing it, church. Come on.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
Let's stand together. Come on.
Your very body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave as the flame on me.
Jesus,
Jesus, your its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope.
Let's sing it one more time. Let's sing. Those of you know it.
We have a hope within our souls, brighter than the perfect day. God has given us a spirit,
and
He wants the world to hear it.
All our doubts
are
sing again.
We have. Death has lost its grip on me. You have
praise the Lord this morning. You may be seated.
Thank you, Pastor Jamie and worship team, for leading us so beautifully in worship this morning. Over recent weeks, we've been doing an acrostic on the word faces, F-A-C-E-S. And we are aiming at identifying those factors that should cause people to see Christ in us. And in a crowd, we should be able to stand out, not because we're wanting to, just because that's what happens when people see Christ in us. And what are those factors? Well, the first one was financial. F, financial. When you're a person of faith, faith gives you a foundation for your finances, and Jesus, or God, has given to us through His Word the way to be a steward of His in such a way that He will supply our needs when we are faithful in our stewardship. And I went over that a few weeks ago, and I've seen it in action in my life for my whole life. When you follow God's plan for your finances, He will provide for you. Even when you don't have the money, somehow He provides. And then we looked at A. It stood for approval, approved by God. It's not that we can earn His approval. We can't do that. But it's that we experience His joy, His approval of us, when we are walking in His steps. Paul told Timothy, study to show yourself approved unto God. And so His approval comes when we are walking in His footsteps, when we are living a holy and righteous life. We just sense the pleasure of God with us. It's kind of, and I'm not trying to brag, it's just the way it was. Chris and I, on our trip home, we usually take 2 days now that we're in our mature years of life. And it's 850 miles from Wichita to home. Chris said, I just want to get home. Let's don't spend the night anywhere. Let's just get home. 850 miles, okay. But I'll tell you what, it was the best trip we've ever had. And all the way, as I drove through the Promised Land there in Kansas and on back towards Indiana, you know, across the Jordan River called the Mississippi, and all the way I could just sense the beauty and the presence of God. And that 850 miles never went so fast. It was just incredible. There's just something about when you're walking with the Lord. And it was beautiful. It was beautiful. And then last week you heard the message on core values that Chris's nephew, Brian, brought to us. And what a wonderful job he did in presenting that to us. And why we have these core values is because God really, really loves us. And when we follow Him, our value system is different than what the world has. And we live at a higher standard of moral living and belief and actions. And when we do that, you'll stand out in the crowd. You really will. It's unfortunate that in many churches, you know, when they take all these surveys and stuff, they're finding that in many churches, the difference between Christians and the world just doesn't show very much. And we've got to change that, folks. You and I serve the King of Kings. And by our life, Jesus said, they will know you are Christians by your love. And so We're looking at these things that cause us to stand out in the crowd, not because we're haughty and arrogant and boastful, but because we follow the God of creation. We serve the King of Kings. And so today we're looking at the E in this acrostic, and it stands for emotional stability. And the title of the message is there, as you see, emotional stability for unstable times. My text today comes from the Psalms, Psalm 121. And I have to be honest with you, I first came across this psalm as a boy, just a young boy. And you'll never guess where I came across it. It was on television, you know, the old black and white, some of you remember. You know, I grew up in the 50s and 60s. We had these little bitty TVs. And one of the great heroes of the day quoted Psalm 121:1. How many of you remember this theologian called the Lone Ranger? A few of you, yeah. The Lone Ranger and his famous Indian sidekick, Tonto. And they were out looking for a hidden treasure that somebody had told them about that needed to be found and brought back to its owners. And so they were out looking for it, and somebody had given the Lone Ranger this note that he would find it out in the desert. And so he and Tonto go out on their the trusty horses, and they get out there and they see this pile of rocks, and on that pile of rocks, the Lone Ranger gets down, he looks at it, and somebody had written a note on it that said Psalm 121, 1. As a young boy, I listened. What did it mean? And he thought for a moment, and then he said to Tonto, "Oh, Tonto, I remember. I will lift up my eyes into the hills, from whence forth cometh my help." And they looked up in the hillside around, and they saw something up there that seemed to indicate this was where the treasure was. So they go up there, and sure enough, they find the hidden treasure. Now, I've never forgotten Psalm 121:1 after that program. First time I've ever preached from it. But you know, there's a great treasure in this psalm, and we're going to find it today. So let's look at that real quickly. Let me read it for you. "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and the earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm, and he will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore." Let's find that hidden treasure. The one who wrote this, we don't know his name. Many of the Psalms are written by David, who became the king, but this one is not attributed to him. So we're not sure who wrote it or when he wrote it, or what the circumstances were. But theologians have speculated that it could be one of two different circumstances around which this psalm came together. The first one, both possibilities are on a journey. The first journey is the journey of life. Perhaps the psalmist, whoever he was reflecting back from a lifelong journey with God. And he's looking back and evaluating his life, as many of us who are in the Senior Connection are doing these days. And we're looking back, and what we couldn't understand back then, we see more clearly today. That no matter what was going on, God was there with us. And so he pens these words. You know, life must have been hard for this psalmist as he was writing, but it's hard for all of us, isn't it? Nowhere in the Bible will you find it saying, life is easy. Well, Jesus says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. But he's not saying that you're not going to have hard times. He's saying, I will be there with you even in the hard times. So perhaps the psalmist here was looking back on his life and reflecting how God had been there every step of the way of this journey that he was on called life. Obviously, he was a strong believer in Yahweh, the Lord. And he writes these tremendous words, as many of us can give testimony to today. But maybe, theologians say, it was really written by pilgrims who were on their way to Jerusalem. Three times a year, the Jewish people would, if they could, go to Jerusalem for a great celebration. It was one of three major celebrations a year, and it was not an easy journey to follow. If they were coming from a distance, there was great treachery. There was great danger. There was great struggles because they had to go through the desert or they had to go through the valleys of Israel. And just to go through the valleys, if you've seen any pictures of it, some of it is just rocky cliffs on both sides, and that's where all the bandits would hang out. And they would come down and rob the people on their journey. And so that's the picture we have of the Good Samaritan. That's what happened to him. He was traveling through the rocky areas where there were cliffs on both sides, and he was robbed. So it was a dangerous journey, and yet they would go in. If they were wise, they would go together, and they would send people out on the cliffs above to kind of scout around to make sure there were no thieves that were going to come in on them. And so on this journey, you know, the psalmist says, I lift up my eyes into the hills. Where my help comes from? Well, it wasn't the hills. We'll get into that in a moment. Along this dangerous journey of life, or along this journey of the Psalms, the people going to celebration, they would sing this song. In fact, this is known as Songs of the Ascent in the book of Psalms. Psalms 120 through 133 are known for being sung as people traveled the journey to Jerusalem. And you can just imagine as they got close to Jerusalem and they could see it up on the Mount Zion off in the distance, they were singing these songs with even greater gusto and enthusiasm and excitement. I lift up my eyes into the hills from whence cometh my help. I think probably this psalm was written by somebody who was reflecting back on his life. And it became so well known that it entered into these songs of ascent, and all of God's people there in Israel heard this and they adopted it for their songs of praise as they went to the temple of God. So, what journey are you on today? What's your journey like? Here's the treasure this psalm gives to us. Number one, God's steadfast love endures forever. Thomas Chisholm, back in the late 19th century, wrote a great hymn. entitled Great is Thy Faithfulness. Great is Thy Faithfulness. He was writing. He had lived a life that physically was always, he was always ill, always in weak condition. And so he passed away in 1960, but at the point of writing this, he knew what it was like to be afflicted in life, and yet he writes this tremendous hymn we all have heard, Great is Thy Faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. All I have needed Thy hands hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. God is always there, watching over us. And that's the second treasure we find. First of all, God's love is steadfast. It never leaves us. And then, secondly, He's always watching over us. And when we look at this psalm, we see the influence of Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. And no matter where you are in the journey of life, no matter what you're going through now, God is there watching over you. Here's the third nugget of truth. He guides and He provides in all situations. He guides and provides in all situations. Joseph Gilmore, in 1862, penned famous words of a hymn we still sing today. He was leading as a speaker along with another person at a camp meeting in Wisconsin. And as he was preaching at this camp meeting, by the way, we still have camp meeting these days, right, Jamie? We've got one coming up in July. You need to go there, and I know we have one down south here. But Joseph Gilmore was preaching, and he was not feeling that stress or anything that life often gives us, but he was just feeling the very peace and the presence of God. And one day, as he finished the service, he was walking along, and he just felt the presence of the Lord with him, and he writes this hymn, He leadeth me. He leadeth me by His own hand. He leadeth me. His faithful follower I would be, for by His hand, He leadeth me. I think that's how I felt Wednesday when we drove back. He leadeth me. Those are the nuggets of truth. Would you agree how important this passage is for us today? Aren't we living in unstable times? Which of us have not been through great struggles over the last year? As a nation, as a world, we've gone through this COVID pandemic. I'm not going to get into all that. You know what I'm saying. It's been a very, very difficult year, and we're still not fully aware of where we stand in all that. To be totally shut down, then try to come back out of isolation. What a stress that's been on all of us. And political unrest with elections and all the rhetoric that goes on these days. Even now, the political unrest is so real you can see it and feel it and almost taste it. Such anger and division. Such incredible, wrathful speaking from one party to the next. There are many today who suffer from fractured self-esteems. They're broken people. There are many struggling and who doesn't with immoral temptations. Pornography has never been easier to get to. And I know it's a struggle, especially for guys. Unstable times. Financial instability and stress, we've seen that and we're going through that. Health issues or loss of loved ones, we go through these unstable times. We're not exempt. Disasters. Natural disasters, whether it's tornadoes or earthquakes, floods. I think this is the first time we've gone to Kansas there wasn't a tornado, but we know what natural disasters are like. I'll never forget when I came back from the mission field and I was hired by the mission agency there in Anderson to work with them, and they gave me this little charge, they called it, of taking care of the disaster relief committee. They just meet about 3 times a year. So I come into the office, and 6 days later, the Haiti earthquake struck. And I was in charge of the national response for the Church of God, and it reached out across around the world to Church of God organizations around the world. And I've never seen anything like it. For the next 5.5 years, I led that committee. Man, it seemed like we were having disaster every other month. In fact, the general director of the Church of God, Ron Duncan, came to one of our meetings after about 2.5 years, and he said, "Smith, ever since we put you in charge of disaster relief, we've had nothing but disasters." He was right. He was right. Then there are man-made disasters that we bring on ourselves or others bring on ourselves. You know, the border crisis on our southern border is totally immoral and unethical, and it's out of control. It's terrible what's going on there, letting drug cartels and human smuggling and enemies of the country just walk across the border. Man-made disasters. We know these are unstable times. And then there's addictions that people struggle with. Those control agents of life that want to take away our freedoms. And there are many who struggle with anxiety. All these unstable times bring on an anxiety that can just cripple us and cause us to be frozen in fear. It's the fear of the unknown, what's coming. Let me ask you this morning, do you operate out of fear or do you respond out of faith? The psalmist found his stabilizer in life. And that's what he's writing about here in Psalm 121. He found that God was his stabilizer. The Jewish pilgrims, as they went to Jerusalem, were affirming their stabilizers. It was God. It was not the mountains that they looked up to. It was the one who created those mountains. And that was their strength. That was their stabilizer in life. They knew their help came not from the mountains, as many of the pagan gods believed. Their help came from the one who created the mountains. Years ago, Chris and I were flying out of Wichita when we were in missions. Got on the airplane and eager to get back to Anderson. But we sat there and sat there and sat there on the tarmac. After about 45 minutes, the pilot came on the intercom, He said, "Ladies and gentlemen, sorry for the delay, but this airplane has two stabilizers on it. And they're designed that when we take off, it stabilizes us as we fly, and it keeps us horizontal, and the other stabilizer keeps us from going vertically down. One of those," and he didn't tell us which one, "was not calibrated correctly, and so we're having to wait for it to be calibrated." We all in the airplane sat back and said, "Take your time." When the psalmist said, "I look up into the hills from whence cometh my help comes from the Lord." He had found his stabilizer in life, and he was writing about it. When the pilgrims went to Jerusalem, they were singing about this one, the one who created the heavens and the earth, because he was their stabilizer in life. So, Psalm 121 reminds us that when we are people of faith, here's how we can respond because of faith, active and working in our lives. First of all, faith knows that God provides in all circumstances. Look at verses 1 and 2 with me again. "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of the heaven and the earth." All circumstances, God's help is with us in every situation. I know some of you are sitting there today perhaps saying, "Well, where is he now because of what I'm going through?" Or as my neighbor said years ago when I was sharing with him about Jesus Christ, he said, "Where was Jesus when my wife died?" This passage does not say, and the Bible does not tell us, we will not go through hard times, because life is hard. Life, and Jesus said, it rains on the just and the unjust. I don't have time to get into the what ifs today, but the Bible is very clear about one thing: God is always there. God is always there. And we often use this verse, Romans 8:28, "For we know that in all things God works together for the good for those who love him and are called according to his purpose." Now, it's not right to use that as a trite memory verse for people going through hard times. That was not designed. Paul was not saying that in a trite manner. He was saying it in a truthful manner, however. And that's how we are to use it, at the right time, in the truth, but not just simply flipping off somebody's struggle and say, "Well, God works together good in all things." No. But the truth is, God is always there. He's always working in our circumstances. Secondly, God protects us. He protects you. Verses 3 and 4, "He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep." God protects you at all times in his way. And when times get tough, don't assume he's AWOL or asleep on the job. Don't blame God for the tough times that come, because there will be tough times. Rather, reach out to God in those times, because it is especially in those times that he's reaching out to you. You learn the most in the tough times of life. Your faith grows the strongest in the tough times of life because you know God is there with you and He's protecting you no matter what may come. Number three, God gives you His peace. Even in the midst of the storm, He will give you peace. The psalmist put it this way, the Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. Your dominant hand was the assumption back then. At your dominant side, the Lord is your shade, and the sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. And he's playing on words here, the sun by day, meaning during the heat of life's struggles or battles, he will put his shade up against you because he's walking with you. He will be there at your side, your dominant side. That's the picture of a great protector there holding his shield up, and he's going to protect you no matter what comes. And by the moon at night, the infirmities we struggle with in the darkness of life, God is always there. Remember the story of the disciples out on the Sea of Galilee? Jesus had sent them off after feeding the 5,000, and they were being tossed and thrown by the sea, by the tempest that had blown up on that sea. They were being tossed, and they were fearful that they were going to die. Jesus had gone up to pray, and he looked down. He comes walking across the water to them. They thought he was a ghost. They started screaming all the more. Matthew 14 tells us, though, that Jesus called out to them and he says, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." And when the tempest of life is tossing you around, and when you think the storm of life is going to throw you overboard, God's word to you is, take courage. It is I. Do not be afraid. Number four, God's presence is constant with us. God's presence is constant with us. 7 and 8 says, the Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life, and the Lord will watch over your coming and your going. In your coming and going. He's with you whether you're coming from somewhere or whether you're going somewhere. And you can just imagine these pilgrims going to Jerusalem, the assurance they had that as they're going to Jerusalem, he's with them. And as they're coming home from Jerusalem, he's going to be with them too. God's presence is always with us. It led Warren Cornwell and George Cooper to writing this beautiful song, Wonderful Peace. Peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above, sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. Those who live by faith and not by sight understand that when we're living by faith, there's a peace that we cannot express. It's as Jesus told his disciples, I'm going away, but I'm coming again. Until then, I leave you my peace. It's peace that the world cannot understand. And Christians, believers, people of faith, know that peace as they travel this journey of life. And then finally, we see in the last part of verse 8, God's promise. God's promise is simply this. I'm going to be with you both now and forevermore. now, you know, forever is a long time, folks. He's with you now, no matter what you're going through. He gives you that emotional stability you need to get through the struggles you're facing. If you call out to him, he's reaching out to you and he's saying, bring all your anxiety to me. Bring all your struggles to me and I will give you my peace that the world cannot give you. For I am with you always, even to the end of the age, he told his disciples. And then forevermore. That's the great joy. You know, I've done about 22 sermons since I've been here. I can hear Dr. Duncan at Church of God. You know, ever since you got there, Smith, people have been dying. Well, I don't mean to be flippant about it. Because in each one, I have seen the peace that God gives to those who trust him. That's why the Apostle Paul said, for me to live, to continue on living, is Christ. I'll serve him, but to die, it's gain because I'll be with God forever and ever and ever, experiencing his peace, his provision, his protection, his love in all circumstances. He's got a place prepared just for me, so don't let my heart be troubled. And that's what he's saying to us today. Whatever you're going through, whatever you're experiencing on this journey of life, he's giving you his love and protection, his promise for all of eternity. And he's saying to you, trust in me. Don't be afraid. I will see you through, both now and forever. And we can face uncertain days because Christ lives. God is here right now. And I feel quite certain there are hurting hearts. And God wants to take that burden from you. Whether it's among these struggles that I listed earlier, or something personal that you're going through, we're going to close and give you an opportunity to come. I know this may not be the practice for many of you, but it is in the Church of God, where we come to the altar and we just lay it at his feet. And we know he meets us here. He can do that in your seat, but something about stepping forward. And you know, none of us know what you're going through. But you can come, and whatever you're facing, it's not lack of faith, it's just, Lord, I surrender this to you. And I just really want to encourage you to come and pray. I have my anointing oil if you need prayer for healing, or if you're going through a struggle, you just need strength and encouragement. These closing moments, will you just come and let the Lord minister to you here in his sanctuary? For he has met you coming in, and he will go with you as you go out. Will you come? Will you receive the invitation that Christ gives you to come and leave it here? And know that he will go with you from this place. Father, I pray that in these closing moments, your Holy Spirit will minister to us where we need it the most. May we lay our burdens down with you and trust in you and not be afraid. Give us that emotional stability, that stabilizer we need for the next week and the days ahead. We are asking in Jesus' name. Amen.
So I encouragement for the future. I, from time to time, get song suggestions from different people. And this one has come periodically from someone who was born just a few years prior to its being written. And they were a miracle baby. And they're living for Christ now, and they are the future of the church. They're born a little bit sooner than their parents wanted them to. But she texted me and she says, can we sing this one? I was trying to figure out a time to fit it in, and this is the right time. You and that I got created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is. You're the only God whose power none can contend. You're the only God whose name and praise will never end. You're the only God who's worthy of everything we can give by your plan. That's just the way.
You are unchangeable.
pray. We know because of the announcement that came to us this week, they have a very, very heart-wrenching request. And as the body of Christ, as their church family, we share that with them. And our hearts are heavy too. But we come together as family to pray with you and for Ashley, your daughter-in-law, and her family. There are others here that may have come for special needs. Be assured, God knows your need. And he's going to give you that peace that surpasses all understanding. We may not know what comes tomorrow, but we know who is already there. And that's what we take great hope and faith in today. So will you all join us as we pray here this morning? Oh Lord, our God, you who created the heavens and the earth and saw us when we were formed in our mother's womb, we acknowledge your presence here right now, and we sense your spirit ministering to each of us who have gathered, but especially we lift up to you Dennis and Julie and their family. These are hard times. And others in our sanctuary have gone through that even recently. And you know our hearts, and you know the pain. You know the struggle we face. But Lord, we lift these concerns to you, knowing that you are the great provider and that you will minister to us where our needs are the deepest, where they are the most difficult. You will be at our right hand. And we pray together now for Dennis and Julie as they minister to their son and daughter-in-law, Ashley. Lord, I pray for this family. We pray especially for Ashley. We pray for your strength to sustain her. And Lord, we know you can heal her if that's your will. And we can't see a better way. So we have to trust you, and we give this to you. And Lord, should you heal her this side of heaven, we will give you all the praise, and you will receive the glory. If you call her home, we trust you for the future. And we thank you for Ashley and her faith in you and for the family. We just pray that you will guide and guard and provide and strengthen and lift them up, especially in these difficult days ahead of transition. Bless this whole family. And Lord, for all these others who have come with special needs that haven't been mentioned, but you know them. And we give our burdens to you, believing that burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus died on the cross for our sins and for all our needs. And through Christ, we can face another day because he lives. So we thank you for that. We will continue to lift up these concerns to you because you're our great provider on this journey of life. Stabilize us for the days and for the journey ahead. We pray in your holy and righteous, loving name. Amen and amen.
You're unchangeable. You're unshakable. You're unstoppable. That's what you are.
Sing it, church.
You're unchangeable. You're unshakable, you're unstoppable.
Stand together.
That's what you are.
Sing it.
You're unchangeable, you're unshakable, you're unstoppable. That's what you are. You are. Before time began, you were on your throne.
to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. One of the things I didn't mention, it's in your bulletin this morning, is that we are having, first of all, the restrooms are somewhat open. Aren't they beautiful? The restrooms aren't always beautiful. They're still kind of working on those, but they are functional as you leave today. Secondly, on the 16th, which is a Sunday evening, we are hosting at 6 p.m. the AC Swing Choir. It's one of their two spring concerts of the year. So we want you to invite your friends. Tell them to come on out, 6 o'clock on the 16th. So thank you for coming today. We hope to see you this week in our midweek services and classes. And then also, there will be a Revelation study starting in two Wednesdays. Not this coming Wednesday, but the following Wednesday here in the sanctuary. So have a wonderful week. We'll see you next week.
Oh, I am too. I'm just going over to
sign up. You bet.
Probably we right were the there. Beggars, now we're royalty. We were the prisoners, now we're